Buenas tardes. Esperemos que hayáis comido bien. Vamos a hacer esta parte final del InterDocs Barcelona de una manera más íntima por la tarde y la vamos a hacer en español. ¿Vale? Ahora vamos a dejar el inglés y vamos a empezar a hacerla en español. Sí que la gente que esté aquí, que sean los keynotes o la gente internacional, tiene traducción simultánea. You have automatic translation into English, if you need. Okay, a la gente que nos acompañan y los keynotes que se van a ir reincorporando, que estaban ahora comiendo aquí en...
For those of you that have not prepared for that, we're also feeling probably much more comfortable without speaking in English, because people was wondering how come we are all speaking in English, given that we're here in Barcelona, most of us are speaking Catalan and Spanish, so how come we're doing that? But anyway, that's life. So let me introduce one of the characters, his most remarkable character, working in Latin America for the last 10 years. Pleasure having brought him here from Argentina, Fernando Irigaray, professor at the University of the National University of Rosario, a city that we very much appreciate here at FCB because of the star football player. He holds a master's degree in new information and communication technologies. He's the director of the Master in Interactive and Digital Communication and the director of Multimedia Communication at the National University of Rosario. He's also the executive director of the Latin American Chair of Transmedia Narratives. For years, he has worked on filmmaking and transmedia with a social and journalistic approach. He's worked in Rosario, very professional-minded, and working specifically on transmedia platforms. He uses transmedia with a consistency, with a meaning behind. So, since I wanted to know Rosario, I went there, invited by himself, and when I got to know the real quality of the work done by DocuMedia, and that's a whole engagement, a whole enterprise by the University of Rosario, I decided to bring Fernando here up until Friday. And so that's a good time to know him and to network with him. So a round of applause for Fernando. Let's start these two last hours.
Bueno, muchísimas gracias, Arnaud.
Thank you very much, Arnaud, for your kind words and for your kind invitation. Thank you all for attending. And now, I will show you a couple of projects. One project we developed at our university, it's called the DCM team, our team, having to do with people trafficking for sex purposes. And then a Latin American documentary. And the first production by the Transmedia Chair, or done by several filmmakers all over Latin America. First of all, throughout these 40 minutes, I'll try and show you what's our theoretical approach so that you see transmedia storytelling.
Ahora sí. Primero entender que dentro de las narrativas,
within transmedia storytelling, we start with an approach on space storytelling, not outer space, but like space as in territory, because it's not just transmedia having to do with the state-of-the-art developments in digital world, nor the gadgetry of the latest generation, but having to do also the development of ecologies, including the traditional media and fundamentally the occupation of the public space and the citizenship intervention. This was our starting point for these productions. The idea behind this storytelling is a spatial storytelling, has to do with a thing that also came to my mind when people were speaking about interactive as a gamification and this search, this quest. But the territory provides a thickness to it, to this storytelling, having to do with this serendipity in trying to find things that you will eventually find other than the ones you were at start looking for. So the idea is to understand the urban space, the city, as a narrative checkboard where you can perform this series of actions and developments that have to do with transmedia storytelling. So you need to understand the cityscape as a transversal, a cross-cutting narrative platform. This is where the actions take place, and this is where they are interlinked, and in understanding the city as an organic hypertext that is constantly developing and growing. So just briefly, transmedia storytelling or narrative is defined as when you go beyond the development of interactive digital media, but rather having to do with the inclusion of traditional media and actions in the territory and to get traction with the audiences and with the users based both on face-to-face interactions and the social media. We're going to speak about a gaming perspective, a quest, and the idea of expanded territoriality, changing the city with an idea of organic hypertext and an idea of the whole city throughout these actions and means. There was also talk about convergence in some of the presentations we heard this morning, and precisely we were also focusing on this. Convergence not just on artifacts, networks or objects, but fundamentally as in convergent storytelling, where the idea of what goes on in this cityscape, where these stories take place. And this also has an impact, and it changes, or at least we believe so, with the definition of what an audience is. Audience, or user, or producer, prosumer. And it goes far beyond. We believe that in order to navigate around these stories with the city in mind, we need to evolve through a new notion, well, nothing that I came up with, but something that I want to bring some value back to it. That's communicational citizenship, which is something that's brought to the fore because of transmedia storytelling, so that you can interact and communicate through these inter-stories. On with some more definitions so that you can get a better grasp of these projects. Another idea that we all incorporate has to do with what we call the street projection. And the idea is that the straightforwardness and like an urban guerrilla in occupying the street and performing actions over the building's facades. This is something that we often use in our projects. So, again, transmedia. I guess all of you know about this, but it's always worth to share some conceptual approaches. It's no longer story, but a storytelling universe, different formats, several channels. Important thing here is how to work both on the design of the strategy and how can you engage with one another. So the transmedia strategy, in our case, is a threefold approach, a triad, and this is something that we need to take into consideration. First, having the adequate content, the right device, the right time. Just like we were talking on fishing, it's just like that. When do you know about fishing? By fishing some more. If you take up too much time, the fish will swim away, and if you take too short, it won't bite. So this is how you work on transmedia, working on development, on practice, and doing by learning by doing. So anything, any story apparently could be transmedia, but this is not always the case. There are some stories, or story ways, that can easily produce a book, a novel, or a film. So when talking about transmedia, it has to do with fundamental things and are related to conversational generation, the idea of the dialogue paradigm in communication. And the conversation flow is key between the parties, between the different platforms during the development. Let me clarify here that, and like we were saying this, or seeing this morning, I'm not just talking about interactive. This is back and forth. I'm no longer on the web doc or the iDoc. To shift into this type of narrative, which is a cross-cutting narrative. So bear in mind, no interaction, basically no social interaction other than interactivity through devices. Also different types of interactions based on the user, on audiences, you would have no transmedia. So without a participatory strategy, there is no possibility for transmedia. And this is one of the major topics to consider for this development that has to do with equipping such a storytelling approach. So this expansion of the narrative world into transmedia creates something in us as producers, which is the expansion of the production life cycle. The work in this type of actions also, mostly low-cost actions or works, where there is much effort in bringing these onto the silver screen or to any screen, and even for an indie film, at most you would be just on screen for 1-2 weeks, and then 6 or 7 months afterwards, if lucky, it will turn into a documentary to be seen on TV, and that's about it for the life cycle. The interesting part in transmedia is that there provides for a recurrent possibility for each element to create the possibility to rebuild that narrative world. So, other than the expressive and the narrative factors of it, it's important to see how the production cycle expands. And to conclude with this idea, just to show you that basically the idea here is to create different entry points, to open up as many gates as possible. There was a question today about metering, about measuring, and the possibility to engage people. And for low-cost works, the interesting part is how to do these by bits, like in the long form, in journalism, as I will later show you. These are usually 60 to 70 minutes, and you could see that on a web talk. Interesting part is how the different articulations, such as the web episodes or small peeled 1-2 minutes, interact precisely through the flagship of transmedia. The piece to bring the audience from one platform to the other, attractioning the audiences. So the important thing is having different inputs, different entry points, different points in the narrative, so that you can move into this type of development. So we're also based on a transmedia documentary in one of the classifications by Denis Renault. He's a filmmaker, a Brazilian filmmaker and journalist, and researcher as well. He wrote a book, first book, to speak about transmedia journalism, and then in some other of his articles, he defines the territorial navigational model, which is the one that we use and where we develop our type of work. So this is not just transmedia, this is what we see as transmedia, and this is just yet another subgenre or format. I don't know, I mean, we are still at our infancy, we're still thinking about it. But this is one of the ways on which we approach transmedia. And this has to do with the long Latin American tradition of the territory appropriation through popular demonstrations. Doesn't mean that there are none in Europe, but mostly these popular demonstrations have taken place in Latin America. And this idea of getting hold of the region, of the territory, starts with an emancipatory view. And we believe that in the coming years, transmedia storytelling, at least in Latin America, which is the place I know most and where I work most, this can turn into an emancipatory story, just like it was for documentaries during the 70s, but now with the popular participation. One more thing we see in this type of transmedia stories is the possibility to bring communication and politics as a way for communicational resistance. Something that we've seen all over Latin America after the comeback of neoliberalism, as we are seeing with the coup d'etat in Brazil, with a shift in power and the changes in structural reforms and the attacks in Bolivia, Ecuador or Venezuela. So let's take a look at the productions. So far I've introduced the framework on which we base our work. If you want to take a look at our productions, you can access them all online through this website, this URL, and you can find these and many more that we've been working on since 2007. The Documedia project, just like Hernán was saying, started off as a weblog idea. Back then we did not even know about this term, weblog. We spoke about interactive documentary, and this is why we came up with this term, documedia. This was a hybrid narrative, bringing together documentaries, social documentaries, and with data journalism, research journalism, and also in recent projects with an awareness campaign. So we probably would not know what docu-media was, but it was to us this convergence, this idea of boundaries and crisscrossing areas, not just on topics, but basically being at the crossroads and at the ever more blurring limits, and also on the narrative approaches. This fifth project, called Women on Sale, Mujeres en Venta, which we were working since 2014, is the one I'll be showcasing here. Yet, like any project, I mean, the flagship here is a web doc. And just like any web doc, you need to navigate through it, because much has to do with the experience and your own subjective experience. Just to show you how this would work. Even the trailer, this is the presentation of the documentary, and it's also seen in many of the pieces that we've used to unify the development. Just a short anecdote, we were working since 2004 18 on this, and 3 days before the premiere and before the presentation at our university, since we work at the rector department, we belong to that place, and precisely 3 days before, all hard disk drives, all memory cards, and all things were stolen. And no equipment, no devices were taken, even though they were like 200,000 pesos. They took nothing of this, but rather the hard disk drives and so on. So it was a true shock to us. Fortunately, we had this backed up, other than some interviews that we had done, and we had these on a safe because we knew that that was sensitive material. So we could improve on that, even though with some lingering fears because of that. Fortunately, things did not worsen, yet fear was thrown in. Fortunately, the university supported us through a press conference. It was quite social support as well. And we did not know whether that was the thing that they were looking for or was something else that they couldn't find. We know that there was nothing new that we were denouncing. These were basically previous charges and cases, and we were only focusing on the recovery of the victims. But given that we are a state-subsidized university, these type of challenges are complex indeed. The interface, it's divided into four chapters, and I will show you some actions in the region, but the idea here is to let people know how human trafficking, how sex trade works. You can access this through the second chapter as well. I mean, second, you know that this is grid-like, you can access through any point. But another chapter having to do with the notion on how the victims are attracted and captured. Then another chapter is prostitution, women's prostitution, and finally, what happened with the development of the victims. What took us more hard work was to find these four cases that bring the narrative in and that have to do specifically with the documentary. Unfortunately, after the stealing, after the theft, one of the girls was really scared and she asked for the whole of her material to be deleted. So we did so, and even though we had that agreement signed by her, just because of ethical considerations, we deleted all her material. So you can access what's the transmedia tour, the Recorridio Transmedia. You can have access to an interactive map where you can denounce a given case, you can add content. There's a comic book, pictures, audio clips, also radio microphones in that turn into postcards that are uploaded. The graphic part, TV show, open TV here, this public TV. The short documentary. This is an old picture, by the way, here. There was a short film, and what we are doing is developing a multi-platform book with all the NGOs telling about the journalistic research that will be published in 2 months' time. Also some mobile episodes and LET campaign.
Bueno. Podés bajar porque es audio. Va. Poquito, ahí está. Bueno, esto tiene que ver, así arrancó la narrativa transmitida.
This is how transmedia storytelling started out. We did this thanks to a grant provided by Canada, having nothing to do with transmedia, but rather with social development. And through that, we were granted $10,000 Canadian so that we could do part of this campaign. Because graphically, for 15 days, we had augmented reality actions. Obviously, we knew that this was experimental, but our idea was that at least between 1 to 3% could download at least one app, UNR, so that they could see the possibility for action through AR. We were given, well, we managed to get up to 2%. The target's not that important. What's important is what's in the graphic, but it was useful to measure this and to start out on some other actions because we wanted to work with several audiences with the idea on having AR actions bringing the physical space with the virtual space together. On the project, parallel to this, where we worked through Let's campaigns in one of the most well-known streets in Rosario, with a 15-second work that was repeated for a month every 15 minutes. We did so mainly focusing on drivers, on car drivers, because when they were stopped at the traffic lights, there was quite an exposure. And together with this, what you are seeing now, we're in a shopping mall. We toyed around with the notion of sex trade and different goods, different articles that were scanned for code bar, and when a woman came in, then a warning sign popped up. So imagine people at the shopping mall playing around with this, and yet the owners of the mall were really interested, because even though we signed this agreement to make this possible, yet we were allowed to extend this some further 2 months because of the social impact that this had generated. I know that there's an expert here in Barcelona. He's an expert in comic-based journalism. One of the things we have seen in this type of developments made us think about a story where we had a court case, a court report about a minor that was under witness protection, and all of them producing a journal statement, a press statement. I mean, Sophia, that was her name, but that was not her real name. And we had no names for the witnesses, nor pictures of them, so it was difficult to have these for a talk. So we started thinking about these, we started thinking about going to traditional media, and we came up with the idea of producing a journalistic based comic book. You can see that these are just made up faces and drawings, yet the text is quite faithful to what you can read in that case court report. That was a case of a girl, she was 16 years back then, and she was brought to Rosario's court, and this is why we told about her story, because we were speaking about the idea of the region, of what was going on. So this was a work, a project, 4-page work, 5 per issue, and you could also download this. And this work, interesting thing here, is that, for instance, this was an unexpected audience for us. It was quite engaging, people really related to it, but it was an important part of the NGOs, basically with women at risk and basically with girls that for some reason, also given that many of the victims end up with perpetrators, because like they end up in jail because they end up perpetrating offenses. And this is how NGOs have been using this tool, and a request that was increasing, that they where they were starting not just on regional jails but also in some other places. This was an unexpected audience to us, which was quite interesting and also meaningful to start measuring some actions. It's not that it was used throughout all Argentina, but then it was somehow used, it was also shared. And we saw that digital works, I mean, not only speaking about the big technological cities, there are still many things in the hands of traditional media, and this is just one of the examples.
Este otro desarrollo tiene que ver con el... la posibilidad de un mapa interactivo donde uno ingresa y es una plataforma.
This is another possibility, an interactive map where you go in, it's a platform, you leave names and you can denounce something, make a claim. We decided to have a census of disappeared girls because of this subject and it is known, or who have been looked into and they're just being added to the map. With the idea of people then starting a claim and we could corroborate whether that is a real claim or not. That's another project. I have, 12 minutes left, so let me go on to another one. That's just a screen capture. If you want to look into it, you can go into DSM team or documedia.com.art /mujeres. And if you do not speak any Spanish, it's also translated into English. It took time and money to translate everything, but we felt it was worth it. Now, this is a different type of project. Same kind of concept as we started out with, but it's more to do with a collaborative approach. It's not just a team working with the audience, but collaborative productions. And the interesting thing here is that people could really get gripped and want to participate. The general concept was to have something that was really viral, short, something easy to produce, perhaps with professional camera, professional equipment, or just with a mobile phone and the possibility of telling a story. The idea was to set up a webisode or a webisode, just 3 minutes, and just have a little tag at the end which gives you a Creative Commons license, saying that it was the Latin American chair for transmedia. It was just that you just had to add that and then upload it on YouTube and from YouTube to a platform, an ad hoc platform, which we prepared. So that was the concept. The idea was to show inequalities in Latin America, in South America, how these huge gaps that you can see in different countries are not that different in say in Mexico or Argentina. That's the trailer.
Feliz do mundo, porque eu sou uma criança brasileira. tenemos agua. Nosotros vivimos varios años y acá y no tenemos agua, ¿no? Y tienen que traer cargar agua del canal para que, para estilar, para tomar, para cocinar y para que se lave el temprano.
Guadalajara puede ser una ciudad muy bonita, pero es como muy racista.
Bueno, este es el tráiler. Estamos.
So that's the trailer. At the moment, we are developing trackers so that it can be downloaded and sort of stuck on streets in Latin America, and then work on augmented reality. And that's where we're at in the development of the project. Right. So this is part of the platform we developed. The idea is simple. You have six parts with different categories. The first one was the webisode, where you upload different stories. Then where we now are is with augmented reality trackers in order to show the experiences, with the idea of turning it into a recursive loop. Each action generates new content, so they feed back one another, and you produce an endless chain to the final development of the project. That's another image. There is georeference, so we know where this comes from. Picture through videos. That is how you upload your video. Video title, YouTube credits title description, the visualization to do with geotagging, with street and number, or just moving the cursor. So the production idea is the reiterative or recursive loop. Each action, each stage will generate more contents for the next. Well, obviously, it's luck and truth. The limits could be, well, success and failure. I don't know whether those are the right words, but we could say that what you might hope for and plan will be affected by what people do and how they react, etc. The idea is, well, as I said, webisodes and geotagging, which we've already seen, and then this is to do with 52 videos, so 52 webisodes and 24 towns. Let me show you one of the videos.
pasar porque si no nos llego a mostrar una cosa.
I'm going to skip that because if not I won't have time for other things. So this comes from a professional production team for people. This is the result of a mobile phone recording in a favela.
Gosto de fazer a tarefa de casa, vou para a escola, vou de manhã e volto de tarde, ajudo minha irmã a botar a roupa para ir para a escola, levo ela. Essa daí é a minha história. Eu sou feliz porque eu sou a criança mais feliz do mundo, porque eu sou uma criança brasileira.
Oi, meu nome é Inês, eu tenho 8 anos e eu adoro ver televisão e para a escola me divirto muito com minhas amigas. Vocês vão lembrar a vida inteira de mim, porque quando eu crescer eu vou ser uma atriz muito famosa. Beijo.
Bueno, como verán, hay...
So, as you can see, there are different possibilities. We also could mention animation. Object animation on paper with documentary voices. So the idea is to use different genres and different people, large production teams or a single person just using a mobile phone. And with that we get those 52 stories. The second stage was the production of a micro short. We had a team with 10 people, and we considered using all the material that was produced, and then we decided to divide it up in categories. Each one is represented by a poster, a picture that you download, and these are the 10 categories: distance, age, gender, economy, species, those, infants, infancy, childhood, love, work, and mobility. The 56 species were classified in these 10 subjects. This is, for example, if you see, this is an example, if you see childhood, which is this, this is what you find. Now, stage three is right now. So the first action is to stick those posters. No, we ask to have those posters stuck on street, but according to countries, there are different laws and regulations. If not in the street, then in university campus or wherever. We could have A4 posters or even bigger posters, that would be our idea. And then through the Aurasmas application, which is a closed code application, there is a free version, which is Aurasmas by HP. You can download that application. It's available both for smartphone and iPhone. And then you can scan the page and discover the contents. The idea is to record. Each action generates a recursive loop and another product. The idea is that at least for each person who stuck that poster, they can record one or two actions and then post it up with the geotagging. Stage four is then you take all these videos that were produced in the on-site actions and everything that was pre-recorded, then you can download it and do a street projection. Same thing on a public building, or if it's very hard, we ask to at least have it outdoors. Even if it is, say, in a university campus, at least outdoors, and then record it and upload that to the platform. Stage number five, with all these contents, all these experiences, and we're already doing this, we are defining authors to have a more theoretical production with an enriched book. We can generate interviews in all these places with all this logic and all the material on the platform. Then we will start producing a television documentary, which will be a collaborative work. And the book will be presented throughout Latin America. And our idea is to broadcast this TV documentary, 26 minutes, in different countries of Latin America, depending on the possibilities there are. So the idea is to see this in public television, private television, education, or whatever, cable, open, wherever we have a chance, we'll be there. This is very much also to do with social activism. The idea is to push this kind of project. So this is there are two types of projection, collaborative projection and collaborative production and an editorial production, which was the other one, Women for Sale. So that's all. Thank you very much for giving me this chance to share our work with you all. Thank you.
Muchas gracias, Fernando.
Thank you, Fernando. We're going to have a five-minute question because your presentation was the keynote for the afternoon, and then we're going to have shorter 15-minute presentations. So do we have any questions for Fernando? I'm sure there will be because it was quite a complex issue. Emiliano Labrador, once again, you are our paid questioner. Right. Good afternoon. Thanks, Fernando, for your presentation. It was fascinating. I work at the university, so I can see the potential of the project. It's really interesting. How do you produce this? Is this all done within the university? Illustrators, programmers, photographers, or do you have outsiders cooperating? Well, the university team is our department with a production company. We have 10 people. And then, depending on the size of the project, obviously. For example, when we did the comic, the comic book, we hired a Uruguayan artist. We have a designer, we have a junior programmer, a senior programmer, senior coder. We have a couple of filmmakers for multimedia artists. So we're quite multidisciplinary, but obviously sometimes you need to hire people. And it also depends on our budget, obviously. Anything else around here? I believe the question was about the budget. Well, you know, when they were talking about 250,000 Canadian, which was about 190,000, well, that would be a dream for us. The Women for Sale project is done on $25,000. And that covers everything. And that is also to do with what the university pays us and then what we've paid. So the 25,000 include 10,000, which were given, no, 9,000, because 11 Canadian dollars, which were given us by some Canadian grant, plus 6,000 euro, which was the Spanish King award, which we got with our previous project on drug trafficking. So we use the money from that award for our next project, which is Women for Sale. We worked on it for a year. I know that this is nothing for you, but you see, this is not a commercial circuit. Although we all get paid. I mean, it's not that we are rich or anything, but we do get paid. And it's to do with social activism and political activism. We believe that, you know, that's part of it. And the other project was also done on awards that we had, like some 500 euro. We decided to create a platform. It's outsider, it's an outsider. And then it is collaborative. Everything is done for free. But then, you know, if you think of something a bit more academic, more research, then you need to consider other possibilities. And yeah, we always do come up with some money, but it's all in all, for the second project, it's not going to be even $8,000. Okay, so on basically shoestring budget, you can do something. I know that, in the morning we were impressed with people who, you know, Fort McMoney, $1 million. But look at that, Women for Sale. Yeah, different scale, different level, but it's a very, very complete product on subjects which are at the heart of documentaries, which is how you can transform society. So different models that we work on. Big model, Canada, France, but look at Argentina. It's not just Fernando, we also had Alvaro, the documentary on historic memory. So in Argentina there are all sorts of things, and the National Film Board, they work with Arte and with Argentina. There's got to be something in that, you know, they go all the way to Argentina to find partners. And I think there is a reason for that. Fernando has given us good reasons for 45 minutes. He'll be with us until Friday. He loves talking. He is from Argentina, and they've got a reputation to maintain. And he's open to chatting, connections. He's going to be around for a while. Make the most of it. Thank you.